Welcome to the show.
Oh, it's great to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Of all the candidates I've seen on the trail, you seem to be having the most fun. Are you?
Oh, it's a very low bar you set, Trevor.
What does that even mean?
You are. You're like out there. You've got like cool music. You're like rapping at like campaign events. It feels like Andrew Yang. You're just like, you're having a good time whilst you're putting out your policy proposals. The only place where you didn't seem like you were having fun was at the debates, where I think you had 2 minutes and 53 seconds of total time that you spoke. What are you gonna do differently in the next one to get more time? You're gonna cough? You're gonna like interject? Are you gonna? I'm assuming you weren't happy.
Yeah, you know, I'm really happy to say though that the debate in Detroit next week is gonna be a very different story. Not only is the format really set up for us to succeed, but right. We just got a poll just now that puts us on the path to qualify for the debates in September as well. So
right.
The debates is a whole string, and unlike a lot of the other candidates, we're in great position to be here the entire way.
So you're running a long-term race. You know, you've come in as somewhat of an outsider. You know, you're an entrepreneur. You come from Silicon Valley. That is your world. And many of your policies have been aimed at or from that direction. One of the biggest ones being you've been called, for some, the doomsday candidate, where you've said, guys, if we don't do something about robots and AI, then it's over for human beings. What do you mean when you say this to people?
Well, I looked at the numbers. I did the math around what happened to many of the manufacturing workers in the Midwest that, in my view, ended up electing Donald Trump.
Yes.
And the trends that affected those communities are now going to affect retail workers, which is the number one job in the United States. It's going to start hitting truck drivers in the next number of years, and driving a truck is the most common job in 29 states.
Wow.
And one of the things that I say is, like, look, when you call a customer service line right now, you get that operator. In a few years, it's going to be an AI that sounds like this. Hey, how's it going, Trevor? What can I do for you?
That's creepy.
It's creepy. But what's that going to mean?
But you think it's going to get that good? You think it's going to get to the point where even human jobs are now completely done by AI and robots?
Certainly a lot of the business process jobs.
Yes.
There are 2.5 million Americans who do customer service for a living right now.
Mm-hmm.
And that job's days are numbered, unfortunately.
So then what do you think you do in that circumstance? Do you put a tax on robots? Do you protect the workers? This is an honest proposal. It sounds funny.
Don't laugh.
No,
that
it sounds
actually
funny,
a very
but
good idea.
It's actually like an honest proposal. Like what do you say to American workers who go, hey, I don't have a job and I wanna change this?
That's exactly right. Amazon right now is closing 30% of America's stores and malls and paying zero in taxes. So what we do is we set up a mechanism where the American people get our fair share of every Amazon sale, every Google search, every robot truck mile, and put a dividend into Americans' hands of $1,000 a month. The freedom dividend would help all Americans feel like we're benefiting from all of the progress and innovation.
That's an interesting and
Yeah, a lot of people like that.
Because, I mean, it takes guts to come out and say, my plan is that we will give every single American $1,000 a month just for being here.
Yeah, it's like Monopoly, but instead of passing Go, it's the first of the month.
You just get, yeah. But now here's the thing. I don't know if you've played Monopoly. It always ends in tears. And that's what people are saying would happen if you gave people universal basic income. You know, yes, the smaller countries have trialed it, but they have found, for instance, in some Scandinavian countries, that then people don't work enough or they don't want to work, they lose ambition. There's a negative effect to that. How do you pay for it, and how do you ensure that it doesn't mean people just don't contribute to society?
Well, when I've looked at all of the studies as to what happened when people got money, only two groups worked less: new mothers who spend more time with their children, and teenagers who spend more time in school and graduate at higher levels.
Oh.
I don't think anyone here has a problem with either of those things.
And then how do you pay for it?
And the way you pay for it, again, if you have a $1 trillion tech company like Amazon paying zero in taxes, then of course you're gonna look around and be like, where's the money going? Where's the
right.
money going? But if you give the American people a slice of every Amazon sale, every AI-driven interaction,
yes.
just a sliver, because the amount of value that that technology is going to generate can literally be measured in the hundreds of billions of dollars.
Right.
We have to put ourselves in position to benefit, and then we can pay for a dividend of $1,000 a month.
But how is this different to tax? Because, I mean, isn't that what tax is supposed to be? Everyone getting a sliver of what people make so that the general society can rise up? I mean, if they find a way to not pay what you're saying, why would... You know what I mean? They don't pay now, why would they pay then?
Well, the great thing is I'm friendly with a lot of the technologists, and they're not evil people. If you say to them, hey, you automating away the jobs, and you're in private, they're like, oh, yeah, I'm doing that.
That sounds evil to me.
Well, they're not doing it deliberately. It's just like a repercussion of their work.
Got it, okay.
And then if you say to them, would you like to give up a slice so that America actually is in position to share and benefit? You know what they say to me? They say, no one's ever asked me that before. So what we have to do is we have to give them, really, in this case, actually, we're not gonna give them a choice. We're just gonna make it happen.
Right.
But half of them are on board with it. Because they're parents, they're Americans.
Right.
Many of them came from other parts of the country. And so they understand what's happening more than most other people do in terms of the economic impact.
That's interesting that they've never been asked, because I met Jeff Bezos and I didn't think of just saying, can I have some of your money? We don't think of these things.
Yeah, maybe we should have asked him.
We genuinely don't think of that. You are tackling this whole campaign from a different point of view. My favorite quotes that you said was, you said, you are the complete opposite of Donald Trump. And the reason was...
Because the... You listen to the reason why. Because the opposite of Donald Trump is an Asian man who likes math.
How do you think math helps you in campaigning? Because it feels like Americans like more of the show. Americans like more of the celebrity as opposed to the numbers and the percentages. Do you think you can break through with just the math of what you're proposing?
What's fun is math is now an acronym that stands for Make America Think Harder. And it's certainly not immigrants that are driving these economic problems.
Right.
It's the fact that our economy is now progressing to a point where things have changed fundamentally. And when I go around to people in Ohio, New Hampshire, there's actually a huge appetite for this type of solution. People say to me all the time, you don't sound like any politician I've ever heard before, and they love it. They're not like, oh, get me a politician, fast. What they say is, you don't sound like any other politician, and this is what we need. So there is such a massive market need. I'm an entrepreneur, and so you see there's a market need. In this case, I saw that our politicians were not going to address the elephant in the room, so to speak.
Right.
And so I decided to run for president.
Well, it's going to be exciting to see you at the next debate. I hope you make it to the next one and the next one, because it's fun having you around. Andrew Yang, everybody.